Students, in this Quizlet review, I'm going to go over disaster planning, then civilian triage and trauma question and answer, and then also environmental emergencies and shock. It seems like a lot, but I think we can move through this pretty quickly. Students usually pick up on this tagging and such when I go over it. So we're going to first talk about disaster planning. And a disaster is an illness or injuries that exceed what the healthcare facility or community can take care of. So some examples of man-made disasters include like the war, arson, bioterrorism, which is kind of interesting, terrorism, nuclear disasters, you know, all kinds of motor vehicle accidents and train derailments, stuff like that, okay? Now, a multi-casualty event can be managed by a local hospital. That's not what we're talking about here, okay? We're talking about disaster or a mass casualty event, which is an emergency when there's too many victims, it overwhelms the healthcare systems in the areas. So the usual cause of multi-casualty events are some type of geographically isolated event, like there's wildfires going on, or, there's some kind of industrial accident somewhere, okay? Now, all of us should be prepared for a disaster, okay? So we need to pack a go-to bag and have it ready to go. So what needs to go into your go-to bag? You can't take everything you own, right? You know that. You only take important papers. And when I say important papers, I mean really important papers, okay? You pack non-perishable food, medications, clothing, and then especially layer clothing if you live in a cold area, and then water. You would pack in plastic containers. So I'm going to be going over mass casualty triage. It's also called military triage. And the reason we do military triage is to do the greatest good for the greatest number of people, because when it comes to a disaster or mass casualty event, we cannot save everybody. And I know this is hard for nurses to understand, but we just can't. Okay, so it's different than civilian triage. Civilian triage is the triage that happens in the ED, right? So I can't, if a patient comes into the ED, say, well, you know, you look like you're going to die, I'm not going to take care of you. We can't do that. In military triage, it's a little bit different. Okay, so we're going to talk about that. It's so we can save our resources for those that can be saved. So there's different tagging categories. And your book is the first book I've seen that has a white category, a white tag. I'll talk about that. But I think if you get test questions on like NCLEX or your proctor, I think they're going to do like the normal four tag system. And I'm going to talk to you about it right now. So a red tag, if you're in a disaster and you've been asked to go tag people, you red tags are, they need help immediately. These are the highest priority people. People that can wait a short time, like 30 minutes to 2 hours, are your yellow tag people. And a yellow tag can become a red tag if something life-threatening happens to them. So something that we missed on the first time around. Now, what's considered non-urgent or the walking wounded are your green tagged people, and they're ambulatory, okay? And they are the ones that make up the largest population of tag people in a disaster. And they overwhelm the system because there's so many of them. And they're not as sick as the red and yellow tags. Patients who are expected to die or who are dead are black tagged, okay? And the highest priority is red. People, like, to give you an example, someone with airway obstruction would be red tagged. Somebody with shock symptoms would be red tagged. Clammy, cold skin is going to be red tagged. Don't look at ages, okay? A patient with shortness of breath would be red tagged. Somebody hemorrhaging would be red tagged. A large abdominal wound without bleeding would be yellow tagged. Open fractures are yellow tagged. Partial thickness burns would be tagged yellow. And a large extensive full thickness burns are classified as black. Okay. somebody with a respiratory rate greater than 30 would be red. Now, you can go through, I'm not going to go through each one of these, okay? But go through these and see how you do. And then a patient with Chain-Stokes breathing, remember, Chain-Stokes breathing usually means death is imminent, so they're going to be black tagged. I already explained the difference between military triage and civilian triage. All right. The nurse may suffer from PTSD, post-traumatic stress disorder, after a multi-casualty event. Now, one thing I didn't talk about, the reason the Joint Commission maintains that hospitals and health systems have to practice disaster skills. Like where I worked before and I was a manager, we had to practice twice a year. The reason you practice twice a year is because you want to be able to function during a disaster, okay? And if you don't practice it, you're not going to be able to, okay? So we want to make sure we're ready before a disaster actually happens. And usually, like, the government shows up, the government agencies show up if there's a disaster. So it's going to be local agencies, community agencies. It's everybody's responsibility when a disaster happens, okay? Everybody has to help. All right, now, let's talk about chemical disasters. So this usually results from the release of toxic man-made substances. And it's difficult to identify, but some of the signs that there's been a chemical leak somewhere is that there's a fog-like or low-lying clouds, and people are dying downwind of a fog. Sometimes there's an atypical odor to the area, like it might smell like mowed grass, and you don't have any grass in that area, something like that. People are instructed to stay indoors, close all windows, close all vents, don't let any air into the house, okay? Now, a nuclear disaster is usually an accident that happened at a power plant, causing the release of radioactivity, okay? So people would then have signs and symptoms of radiation sickness. So radiation sickness attacks your bone marrow, so they're going to have a low white count, so they have leukopenia. They're going to have low thrombocytes, so they're going to be, you know, they're going to be prone to bleeding. They'll have GI, it irritates the GI tract. They're going to have nausea, vomiting, and diarrhea. It irritates the skin. They're going to have burns, radiation burns, and also hair loss. It's neurologically toxic, so they're going to have lethargy, confusion, and convulsions. Okay, with bioterrorism, it's the deliberate spread of pathogenic organisms into a community. And so here are some of the signs of bioterrorism, like they attack your food sources. So you may seem like farm animals dying in large numbers of patients present into the ED with the same signs and symptoms or with food illnesses. That's another sign of bioterrorism. So there's different categories of bioterrorism agents. Now, category A are the most significant because they're easily disseminated, like anthrax, okay? Anthrax is easily disseminated because it's airborne. It's spread through the air. So somebody can put, like, spores into the air, and you don't even realize you're breathing them in, and once they get into your alveoli, they start multiplying. So anthrax is not contagious, which I found interesting. In other words, if I'm outside and I take in those spores, I could get anthrax. But if you weren't exposed, you're not going to get it from me. It's not contagious. But that's just some interesting things about bioterrorism, things you need to look out for as a nurse. So next, I'm going to talk about civilian triage and trauma. Okay, so as a nurse, wherever you live, if people know you're a nurse, they're going to come to you for advice. Okay, that's just the way it is. That's why when I'm sitting on a plane, I never tell anybody I'm a nurse. And I learned that after being a nurse for a long time. So let's talk about pre-hospital emergency care. So usually you may come across accidents, or poisoning. Those are probably the major things you're going to see when you're not working in the hospital, in the community. So Good Samaritan laws do protect you as long as you act in good faith and you practice within the scope of your practice. Like, for example, if I run into somebody who I think needs a tracheotomy, I cannot perform a tracheotomy because it's not within my scope of practice. I would have to do everything I could to save the person within my scope of practice. Okay, so before you help a victim of an accident, the first thing you're going to do is survey the scene to make sure it's safe. I ran into, I'm going to say a kid, but he was like a teenager who was hit by a car, and it was in the middle of Hull Street, actually. And that was the first thing I did. I'm like looking at the oncoming traffic, because you never want to move somebody from the scene. What happened, it was like, I think it was a Sunday afternoon. There wasn't much traffic and there was quite a crowd gathering. So they stood around him, so we didn't move him until help got there. All right. If you ever come across a person with impaled objects, like a knife, okay, do not move it. Do you guys remember that guy from Australia? He was like, I can't remember his name. He like loved the animals and had all the animal shows. Well, he had a stingray stinger in his chest and they pulled it out and he ended up dying of cardiac tamponade. Had they left that in, he would have, and they pulled it, waited to pull it out in the hospital, they could have probably saved him. Water safety with diving. Okay. When it comes to spinal cord injuries or the potential of spinal cord injuries, we never want to move somebody unless we absolutely have to move them. Okay. That's why, like, if you come across somebody in a motorcycle accident, you don't take off the helmet unless you absolutely have to, right? Don't remove from the water until EMS arrives. Okay, bystanders, meaning you, I, anybody, should immobilize the head and neck and keep the face above water. Only remove from water if they're not breathing and cannot, and you cannot provide rescue breaths in the water. Start CPR for no pulse, you'll have to take them out of the water. For drowning victims, if breathing and have a pulse, put in recovery position, which is side lying. If somebody is choking, I cannot get over the amount of people that choke on meat. It's just crazy working in endoscopy, getting those phone calls to come in and get a bolus of food out of somebody's esophagus is unbelievable. So if somebody is talking to you, they are not fully choking. So just encourage deep breathing and coughing. If they are giving you that universal sign, you know, just say, can I do the Heimlich maneuver and try to get that bolus out. Motor vehicle accidents. You only move the patient if these conditions are unsafe, like the car's on fire. There's pooled gasoline, so that's a potential for a fire. The patient is got thrown from the car and they're lying on hot pavement because you can get big burns from hot pavement if there's oncoming traffic and it's really busy. If the car is submerged in water or snow, okay, that may be some reasons to move somebody. With poison, okay, first thing, somebody calls you, their kid drank whatever, tell them to hang up and call the poison control center. They need to be ready with the name of the poison, the patient's weight, age, medications, and medical history, and do not induce vomiting unless you're instructed to do so. A lot of poisons can damage the esophagus, so you don't want to bring something up that's going to damage the esophagus, okay? If you come across a patient in the community who's dropped and they have no pulse or respirations, you're going to start your high-quality chest compressions. So most patients who do have life-threatening injuries will come to the ED care. So emergency nursing care is guided by the ABCD principle, and I am going to teach you that. It follows medical protocols, which means when a patient comes in, they're going to probably see the triage nurse and then a nurse, right? The ED nurse. Well, the ED nurse is going to do an assessment, and they're going to know exactly what to do based on the signs and symptoms, and they're not going to wait around for a physician to order something for the patient. They'll already know, patient comes in with chest pain, I'm going to get an EKG, I'm going to do the labs, blah, 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 okay? ED care is chaotic and episodic. Episodic means the patient comes in, you stabilize them and you get them to the unit they need to get to, okay? Emergency nurses provide mostly acute and critical care, and they have to have a wide base of knowledge because they provide care from cradle to grave, so throughout the lifespan. All right, so when patients come in, they're triaged. And the reason patients are triaged is because you have to see the most critical patients first. So if somebody has what may look like a UTI and they're young, they may be sitting there all day waiting to be seen, whereas sicker people are going to be seen first. So before I go into triage, I'm going to talk about some conditions that you might come across if you're in the ED. Okay, so you might have somebody with abdominal trauma who is an exposed viscera. Just like after surgery, a patient that has eviscerated, you are going to get normal saline soap, sterile dressings, and keep that those dressings moist. Okay, place the patient supine with the knees flexed because that'll put less stress on that area. The conditions, so when you're dealing with chest trauma, the conditions that result from chest trauma is, of course, death, rib fractures. Patients can have what's called a flail chest, a pneumothorax, hemothorax, tension, pneumothorax, and cardiac tamponade. And I'm going to explain these. So rib fractures, very common. We never bind ribs. They're gonna knit together naturally over a course of a couple months. So you got to manage the pain so the patient's going to breathe because it's so much pain and you kind of have to breathe continuously, right? So they're going to need to manage pain. Then head of bed, usually sitting up is best. With flail chest, there is a little segment of the ribs that have broken off in both places, like this side and this side. And so the key word you're looking for is paradoxal breathing, because when they breathe in, normally your chest goes out. This segment is going to go in. So that's what you're looking for. Okay. It's going to, and they're just going to treat them symptomatically, but just something to look for. Now, a pneumothorax means there's air in the pleural cavity. Okay. So something has caused this lung to drop, a drop lung. It could be that they had a procedure, they had trauma, they were stabbed. You could be you were putting in a central line with the physician and they dropped the lung, so they had a pneumothorax, okay? So with a pneumothorax and hemothorax, you're not going to hear lung sounds on the side of the pneumo or the hemothorax, and they'll have shock-like vital signs. So tachycardia, tachypnea, dyspnea, and a low blood pressure. This is hemothorax, and I have a feeling it might be a Proctor topic. So this means blood in the pleural cavity. So if you were listening to lung sounds here, you wouldn't hear them because here are the lungs and this is where you hear the airflow. Okay. So again, no lung sounds here, dyspnea, feelings of impending doom, and shock-like vital signs. Now, a tension pneumothorax could happen from trauma, and it happens when there is a sucking chest wound and air goes in, but it can't go out, okay? So everything gets pushed to the opposite side. So one of the things you're going to look for is a deviated trachea to the opposite side of the injury. Cardiac tamponade, this can happen if somebody hits like the steering wheel with their chest or if somebody gets stabbed. It's just the pericardial sac becomes filled with either blood or fluid, and then the heart can't pump efficiently. So the patient's going to need an immediate pericardiocentesis. So the physician just puts this needle in and takes the fluid out. Okay, the classic signs of cardiac tamponade are hypotension, muffled heart sounds, and JVD. The sign you're going to look for is pulsus paradoxus, so a paradoxal pulse. That's a sign of cardiac tamponade. Chest tube is going to be used for somebody that has hemothorax or pneumothorax or tension pneumothorax. And then some other random things. Anybody that comes in with a sexually transmitted infection, because they do, because they don't have primary care sometimes, they're going to be on standard precautions. And then these are the patients, if they come in, you need to be ready with intubation tray. So Guillain-Barré patient with paralysis to the waist, remember they're usually the ones that like had a flu shot or they had some kind of respiratory virus and 6 weeks later they come in and they're having ascending paralysis. Well, once it gets to the waist level, it's time to intubate. Glasgow coma scale, less than 8. Anybody with inhalation injuries, which I talked about in our burn lecture. And then post-thyroidectomy and parathyroidectomy, because of the location is where that is. Remember, we always keep an extra trach tray in their rooms, but if they start getting like stridorous, they're going to need that trach, okay, because that's alarming. Anybody that has abdominal trauma, you're also going to check for chest trauma. Anybody with a head injury, you're also going to check for spinal cord injury, so remember that. Now, with abdominal trauma, there are some signs you need to know, and we've already taught you this. So Cullen sign is bruising around the umbilicus, and it means that the patient has some type of intraperitoneal bleeding. And Gray-Turner sign is bruising around the flank, and that means retroperitoneal bleeding. If your patient has had trauma and they complain of pain in the left shoulder, that's called Kerr sign. It could mean that they have a splenic rupture. And if they have Kerr sign in the right shoulder, pain in the right shoulder, it could mean they have liver trauma. So Kerr sign means referred pain. So just think of the liver is on the right side and the spleen is on the left side. But those are the two organs that are most often damaged in trauma. Now, basilar skull fracture, we talked about this early in the semester. That puts people at risk for meningitis. So you're looking for an increased temperature, but also remember they have raccoon eyes and they have battle sign, which is bruising behind the ears, okay? If they have drainage, you're going to check it for glucose and halo sign. So halo sign, you put the cerebral spinal fluid on a gauze pad, a white pad, and these concentric rings form, and that's called halo sign, and then you know that there is a cerebral spinal leak. All right, the metabolic emergencies that you most often see in the ED include hypoglycemia, thyroid storm, Addisonian's crisis, and DKA. So we're gonna talk about some of these. We've had them throughout the semester, so this will provide a good review, because remember, your exam is gonna be cumulative. Mostly new stuff, but cumulative too. So if somebody comes in with a stroke and they have aphasia, remember that's a stroke on the left side of the brain. So the left side of the brain is damaged. If they have Broca's aphasia, that is in the frontal lobe. And if they have Wernicke's, it's in the temporal lobe, okay? Because I think that might be a proctor topper. Okay, so when you're talking with somebody with aphasia, be patient, speak slowly, face the patient, ask yes or no questions, use gestures, okay? Use nonverbal gestures, and then you want to use your normal voice. Don't talk loudly. They can hear, they just can't talk, okay? And then the nurse, if somebody comes in with a mild TBI, which is a concussion, they need to report any change of LOC because they're going to be sent home. Or if they have like projectile vomiting or, you know, change in their balance or double vision, they need to come back to the hospital. Signs and symptoms of hypoglycemia, blurred vision, tachycardia, diaphoresis, shakiness, excessive hunger. And then Addisonian's crisis. So a patient with Addisonian's crisis usually has stopped, either they have some stress in their life or they stop taking their steroids. So look for hypotension, weight loss, hypoglycemia. They'll have a high potassium and low sodium. Cushing's, remember, is like the opposite at Addison. So it's caused by prolonged exposure to high levels of cortisol. So in other words, there's an over-secretion of glucocorticoid hormones. So the patient is going to have a high sugar. With DKA, recall with DKA, we give high amounts of IV fluids with regular insulin. Regular insulin is going to move potassium inside the cell. So look for a low potassium and report that. With DKA, the nurse needs to teach the patient that when they're under stress or sick, they need to check their blood sugar more frequently to prevent this from happening again. And then the signs and symptoms of thyroid storm, everything's up, right? The patient's irritable, anxious. They have a high temp, high heart rate, high PB, high respiratory rate. And you need to catch this early. And then patients that are being treated with medication to treat hyperthyroidism, you're going to look for signs and symptoms of hypothyroidism because the medication may work too well. All right, the primary survey. Now, this is what your book uses as the triage method. This is often used in the initial assessment of a trauma patient. So it's based on A, B, C, D, E. What you're going to do before you perform the primary survey is put on your PPE. Now, this survey only takes 60 seconds, so it's a quick survey, okay? You're not doing an in-depth head-to-toe assessment. It's quick. So the A stands for airway and cervical spine, okay? So remember, when somebody has a hard cervical collar on, we do not remove it until the physician looks at the x-rays and clears them for it to be removed, okay? So remember, I talked about patients that need intubation, so Glasgow Coma Scale less than 8, somebody with inhalation burns or burns to the face would need it. So the reason A is airway, because that's the highest priority, establishing a patent airway. If patients come in with a cervical spine injury and they have that hard collar, you're not going to be able to put the head back. So do a jaw truss to open the airway. Okay, and signs and symptoms you're going to look for with airway problems or inability to speak and dyspnea. All right, the B is breathing. Okay, so students kind of get airway and breathing. Airway is airway. So is the airway open? And then breathing is you're looking at the ventilatory efforts. Like, is the chest going up and down? Take your stethoscope and listen to the lung sounds, because that's how you're going to know the patient is really breathing. Okay. If they're not breathing well, they could be moving, but not moving air. Okay. So that's why I said, take your stethoscope. You might have to use the bag valve mask, which is your ambu bag, to do ventilations. The C is circulation. And, this is the focus if you've already taken care of A and B, like when burn patients get in, right? You want to check the airway, check their breathing, boom, get those two IVs in because they're going to need a lot of fluid. People come in hemorrhaging, you got to get those two large bore IVs in. And then if somebody is hemorrhaging, hold pressure. We never use tourniquets unless pressure doesn't work. All right, the D in the ABCD stands for disability. This is where you do a rapid assessment, neurological assessment. And I know you think the Glasgow Coma Scale is like hard, but if that's something you do every day, that's not going to be really hard. They use this other method too as a quick method, but just know it's disability. And then E stands for exposure. So this is where we remove all their clothing, especially if it's like wet and cold. And you save it for evidence if it's like, a crime or anything. And then you want to prevent hypothermia. So we call this the strip and flip, because you're going to take off their clothes, you're going to look at them head to toe, and then you're going to log roll with 4 or 5 people and check the back. Now, this is a quick look. You're looking for if there's anything impaled. You're looking for bruises. You're looking to make sure they're not bleeding somewhere in the back. That's the primary survey. Now, the secondary survey, I'm really not going to go into a lot of detail. This is just what I'm going to tell you. This is where you do more in-depth things, like you do the labs, you insert Foley's, you insert an NG tube. Everything else is done in the primary. The important things are done in the primary assessment. All right, so let's go now to environmental emergencies. And then we'll do shock and you'll be done. Okay, with your environmental emergencies. Okay, first of all, the vulnerable patients, we're gonna talk about heat-related injuries first, are gonna be your young and old. People like athletes working out in the heat, homeless individuals that don't have a place to go in the hot times of the day. So the health promotion interventions to prevent heat-related illnesses is like, don't go out when it's really hot and humid. Avoid alcohol and caffeine. Avoid sugary drinks like soda. Remember, sugar is like an osmotic diuretic. So if you drink sugary drinks, it's going to make you pee more, right? You're going to have a higher urine output. Drink before you become thirsty. Wear sunscreen always. Wear clothes that are going to protect you. So you want to wear lightweight, light-colored, loose-fitting clothes. Exercise early in the morning and evening if you're going to exercise outside, and rest frequently. So there's something called heat exhaustion and something called heat stroke. You want to prevent heat exhaustion from becoming heat stroke. So who's at risk? Old and young, right? So with heat exhaustion, okay, heat exhaustion is like flu-like symptoms, and it's because the patient becomes dehydrated. They have excessive sweating, cool, clammy skin, muscle cramping, okay? So low sodium because of the sweating. Whereas in heat stroke, they don't sweat at all, okay? They have a high temperature, usually greater than 104. The cardinal sign that lets you know that they're in heat stroke is they get bizarre confusion. They get confused. They'll have red, hot, dry skin, not cool and clammy like heat exhaustion. Okay, so with heat exhaustion, they'll have headache. They don't have a high temperature either in heat exhaustion. All right, so with heat stroke, this is a true medical emergency. People can die from this. It can be fatal, so you have to recognize it early. If you suspect somebody has heat stroke, keep them NPO so they don't aspirate. And they're going to be, you know, they'll go to the hospital and they will be cooled off in the hospital, usually in the ICU. So signs and symptoms of heat stroke, the temp is greater than 104. They're going to be tachycardic, tachypneic, and have a low blood pressure. The patient will be confused. They will not be sweating. Keep them NPO. All right. And you can go through all these like little things. Okay, so the hallmark sign of heat stroke is confusion. Now we're going to switch a little bit and talk about snake bites. So just generally with snake bites, you never want to apply ice or a tourniquet to the area because you want, you don't want to sequester like the venom. Okay, so don't use that. Splint the area to minimize movement. Place, if it's a limb, place the limb at or below the level of the heart. Not, you don't want to elevate it, you want to immobilize. Those are two different things. Circle the bite if you happen to have your Sharpie with you and note the time. And then remove all jewelry and tight clothing. And this goes for any type of bite. If somebody gets bit on the hand or the foot or anything, you want to remove anything that's tight because that injury is going to swell before you know it. The things that are contraindicated with the snake bite are NSAIDs, ice, heparin, tourniquets, and corticosteroids. You're not going to do any of that. First aid involved in bee stings is, you know, depending if they have an allergy to it, that'll dictate what you're going to do when they get there. Again, remove any jewelry or tight clothing. Now we're going to talk about cold-related injuries. So older adults are really prone to hypothermia. They should be keeping their houses in the winter at 65. And I know some of them try to save money and don't want to do that. But older adults have less subcutaneous fat and they're not as active. They have a decreased metabolism as well that puts them at more risk. So what we want to teach people to do to prevent this is have them exercise if it's cold, like get up and walk around more. Layer clothing. So you put lots of layers of clothing on. Wear a hat. A hat is great. The hat keeps a lot of heat inside your head. Everybody should be using sunscreen and sunglasses when they're outside, no matter if it's hot or cold. Do not restrict food or fluids in the cold weather. No alcohol. It's not going to make them warmer. And eat high energy foods. That's really important. Okay, hypothermia, the signs and symptoms. They're going to be shivering. Shivering is good for our body because it keeps it warm. They'll have slurred speech and decreased muscle coordination. So I kind of think about it, it's kind of like being a little drunk, right? The signs and symptoms is what I think about, okay? If they stop shivering, that means they've gone to the next level of hypothermia. There's mild, moderate, and severe, and you don't need to know the signs and symptoms of each one. But loss of shivering means they've gone to a higher level, okay? So pre-hospital care, you're going to remove wet clothing. They're going to need some warming. We always warm the core when it gets above the mild level, so that means they have to be in a hospital. That's all I'm going to tell you about that. So frostbite. So frostbite is freezing of the tissue fluid, and it results in damage to the skin, obviously. People can lose limbs over this. Frostbite is really like a burn. So the treatment is rapid rewarming, and it's very painful, so you need to give IV opioids. They're going to be put on ibuprofen around the clock to decrease inflammation. We never massage or use dry heat like a heating pad. And then you need to assess for compartment syndrome and give a tetanus shot. Okay, so if they have a second degree frostbite, it's going to look like this. It's kind of like milky fluid in there, and just like a second degree burn. Okay, so the skin is reddened with blisters. In third degree, this is a full thickness burn. And this is, look, it has black eschar, and they have these blood blisters. So the blisters are filled with blood. Look at, they lost their digit. And then you know what compartment syndrome is, and you know what the hallmark is that, but you're going to, you know, watch out for compartment syndrome for people that have frostbite or circumferential full thickness burns. All right. Now, the last thing is shock, which will be really short and sweet. Okay, so shock. Shock means inadequate tissue perfusion. The hallmark is going to be low perfusion to the organs. So your mean arterial blood pressure needs to be maintained at 65 and higher. When it goes lower than that, the organs are not going to be perfused and shock will happen. Now, there's four different types of shock. The initial presentation and the management might be a little bit different, but it's a syndrome. So although the initial presentation might be a little bit different, they're all going to go through the same physiological process. So I'm just going to kind of group them all together for you and just tell you when there's differences. So the first sign you are going to see in shock is an increased heart rate. Then you're going to see tachypnea. So you really need to be counting respirations, especially for patients at risk for shock. And you know what I'm talking about, okay? The reason is a lot of patients in the hospital today are on beta blockers. They're not going to have the response of an increased heart rate. So you're going to have to rely on tachypnea, because an increased tachycardia and tachypnea happen way before they get hypotensive. So you have to recognize that early. Okay. So your patient may have postural hypotension, slow cap refill, diminished pulses, and flat neck and hand veins, unless they have cardiogenic shock. All you have to know about cardiogenic shock right now is it's like extreme left-sided heart failure. That's it. Okay. Increase, they're going to have tachypnea. I told you that. They'll be hypoxemic. Anytime you have stress, like we talked in burns, the GI system is not going to work. It's going to shut down, and they may get ulcers, and they will have a increased glucose level because the body's under so much stress, even if they're not diabetic, okay? So they're going to have a paralytic ileus. They'll have a decreased LOC because their brain is not being perfused. The brain receives like 25% of the cardiac output, and the kidneys receive 25% of the cardiac output. So if they're not, if the cardiac output goes down, like in shock, they're going to have a decreased LOC and decreased urinary output. Okay. Skin is going to be cool to clammy. Now, the exception to high heart rate is neurogenic shock. It's the only shock that presents with bradycardia. Okay. A lactate level greater than 2 indicates shock. Hypovolemic shock results from blood or fluid loss. I think you know that. So the treatment is going to be to replace blood and fluids. The major nursing responsibility is just what I was talking about before. You're going to pick up on the early signs. So prevention is key. Remember that. Anybody that has hypodynamic shock, so that's a patient with hypotension, you're going to put them flat, elevate the client's feet, and keep the head of bed no more than 30 degrees. Okay, so that's not cardiogenic shock. This would be like more septic shock, neurogenic shock. But ATI usually asks that kind of question as a proctor topic. Okay, there's your Quizlet review.